Hello, I'm Maruk Said, your microbiology guide. Let's explore in-depth micro techniques and uncover groundbreaking insight together on this educational journey into the fascinating realms of microbes.
Cloning operates primarily by copying a segment of DNA, such as a gene, repeatedly. But this is equally fascinating and carries tremendous implications. It essentially entails extracting a gene from our DNA, inserting it into a plasmid, which is a small circular piece of bacterial DNA, then prompting bacteria to replicate that gene replication, and use it to produce proteins for us. Gene expression. Okay, so our DNA and plasmid DNA share some similarities. First off, both are double-stranded molecules, with each strand made up of sequences of four nucleotides: adenine, A, guanine, G, cytosine, C, and thymine, T, arranged in a specific order, like words in a sentence. Secondly, to form the double helix, the nucleotides use their bases, A, T, C, and G, to form hydrogen bonds with the bases on the opposite strand. Bases bond according to the rule of complementary base pairing, which states that in DNA, A always pairs with T using two hydrogen bonds, while C always pairs with G using three hydrogen bonds, always pairs with G using three hydrogen bonds. However, the difference between our DNA and plasmids is that our DNA is organized into 46 linear chromosomes, whereas plasmids are circular, like a molecular DNA necklace. If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated. Now, the first step in DNA cloning is digesting our DNA, which contains the target gene we want to clone, by using restriction enzymes, which bind to specific nucleotide sequences called restriction sites. There's a huge number of these restriction enzymes that recognize hundreds of different DNA sequences. So say we used the restriction enzyme EcoRI, which binds to every GAATTC sequence of DNA and breaks the DNA between the G and the first A. We can use this enzyme to cleave both our double-stranded DNA containing the target gene as well as the plasmid DNA, which is where we want to insert it. So, for a simplified example, let's say we have a double-stranded DNA fragment that looks like this. And remember, the two strands of DNA are antiparallel, one running from a 5 to a 3 direction, and the other from 3 to 5, a bit like two snakes coiled up together, but facing opposite directions. The bold parts are the restriction sites that EcoRY recognizes, and the part in between them is the gene we want to multiply. Now, when we add some EcoRI to this scenario, it comes in and cuts right between the G and the first A on each strand's restriction site, leaving us with this. Now, even though plasmid DNA is circular, remember that the same thing happens when EcoRY recognizes its restriction site there. So basically, what we're left with from our DNA is our target gene, which ends with bits of the restriction sites. We call these sticky ends, and the plasmid, likewise, now has a gap with sticky ends on either side. This allows the coolest thing to happen. When we take our target gene and its sticky ends and put it together with a plasmid and its sticky ends, all we need to do is add an enzyme called DNA ligase, and the two come together like puzzle pieces. This new hybrid DNA is called recombinant DNA. Now, just something to bear in mind. along with our target gene, a gene for antibiotic resistance is also inserted into the plasmid. This will come in handy later on when we want to selectively grow only the bacteria that contain our recombinant plasmid. Speaking of which, let's get that plasmid inside the bacteria. For this, we'll need to put the plasmids and a fresh lot of, say, E. coli bacteria in the same test tube. Then, a type of environmental stressor, like a heat shock, is applied, which makes the E. coli membrane more permeable to the plasmids. However, not all the bacteria respond well to this kind of treatment, so while some of them incorporate the plasmids, others don't. In order to separate out the population of bacteria that has incorporated the plasmid and therefore contains our target gene, we take them out of the test tube and move them onto a brand new agar plate to grow. This plate has all the nutrients E. coli needs to grow and multiply, but with a twist, it also has some antibiotics sprinkled in. Bacteria that haven't incorporated the plasmid lack the antibiotic resistance gene, so they are virtually helpless in the face of antibiotics and die off. On the other hand, those that were clever enough to allow a plasmid inside carry the protective gene, which allows them to multiply in spite of the antibiotic. As these bacteria divide, they replicate their DNA and also the plasmid. So each time the number of bacteria doubles, so does the number of plasmids, and in turn, our target gene. But remember, genes code for proteins. So basically, this means we can use the bacteria as protein factories, meaning they transcribe our genes along with their own and produce proteins that we can then extract and use. For example, let's say our target gene was the CFTR gene, which codes for a protein called cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator, a chloride channel that shuttles chloride ions in and out of cells. This gene is mutated in individuals with cystic fibrosis, so they produce either too little of this protein or an abnormally shaped one. In either case, the protein can't function properly, so patients typically face issues with their pancreas and lungs. And while we may still be some way from a full genetic cure for cystic fibrosis, some studies have shown that by using a vector to introduce the normal protein and then administering it to patients, lung function can be improved.
If you have watched till here, don't forget to subscribe to Family of Science Lovers. Press the bell icon button so you are always updated.
All right, as a quick recap, DNA cloning refers to multiplying small bits of DNA, like genes, and it uses small, circular pieces of bacterial DNA called plasmids. The first step is digesting our DNA, which contains the target gene we want to clone, using restriction enzymes that bind to specific nucleotide sequences, called restriction sites. The same restriction enzyme is used to cleave both our DNA, containing the target gene, and the plasmid DNA. This creates a target gene with sticky ends and a gap in the circular plasmid DNA. When DNA ligase is added, the two join together like puzzle pieces to form recombinant DNA. Then, the plasmids are transferred into E. coli bacteria, and the bacteria are selectively grown to produce multiple copies of the target gene or its protein product.
Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, press the bell icon button. Thank you.